Hello, my name is Prajnahridaya, and welcome to the Padmaloka Shrine Room. We've just, as a community, watched Padmavajra give a talk in here on the other side of the room, and I'm here now on Prajnaketu's invitation to talk to you about one of the 7-point mind training verses. So thank you, Prajnaketu, for inviting me to give this talk. I do love the 7-point mind training. It's been a source of great inspiration for me, something I've come back to several times actually. And what I'm going to be talking about is the slogan, "All Dharma agrees at one point." All Dharma agrees at one point. Or another translation is, "All teachings have one aim." And I particularly love this slogan, because these are slogans, they're things that we memorize, that we can bring to mind in the course of our daily life. What I particularly love about this is giving this sense that all the teachings, all the different, all Dharma, which means teachings in this case, of Buddhism, it all has one aim. It's all for one single purpose. It's so easy to kind of get bogged down with all these, you know, wonderful, all these different aspects, all these different, or visions even of what the Dharma could be, what it leads to, the different qualities. It can be easy to sort of get a bit confused and lost in that, and kind of this like vast jungle of potentialities and teachings. But to say that it has one aim is, in a way, is quite radical. I find it quite relief in a way. That's kind of, I feel like, what I'm always looking for. What is the essence of the Dharma? What is it that everything we're doing is leading towards? It's said that I've heard it said of Bhante Sangharakshita, the founder of Tri Ratna, that someone said of him that he only ever did one thing, whether he was teaching, organizing, meditating, doing nothing, working hard. Whatever he was doing, somehow, through all that, there was this single thread, this single sense of purpose that expressed itself in the way he was and what he was doing. So what is this one thing? What is it that the Dharma, what is this one point that all Dharma agrees on? This could be spoken of in many, many different ways. You know, we could say for the attainment of enlightenment, we're used to hearing and saying that. We could say it's all for love. You could say it all agrees on awareness, on mindfulness. But this is what the 7-point mind training says. Well, this is how it's Jamgon Kongtrul speaks of it in his book, The Great Path of Awakening, which is a book on the 7-point mind training, which I thoroughly recommend. It goes through the verses in a very concise, very powerful, potent, uncompromising and inspiring way. So this is what Jamgon Kongtrul says of this slogan. "Since the aim of all Dharma, both Mahayana and Hinayana, is simply to tame ego clinging, as you practice Dharma or work at mind training, ego clinging should decrease. If your efforts in Dharma do not counteract ego clinging, your practice is meaningless. Since this is the one criterion that determines whether Dharma practice is effective or not, it is said to be the yardstick by which a Dharma person is measured." So he says the aim of all Dharma is simply to tame ego clinging. So what does that mean? What is ego clinging, and how do we tame it? Well, in a way, that's kind of need to talk about the whole of the Dharma, really. But so really, I just want to kind of explore a bit what it might be like, or the sort of what I find particularly inspiring anyway about thinking of the Dharma in this sort of way, in terms of taming ego clinging. In a way, I don't actually want to say too much about what it is, like to try and pin it down, because I think one of the advantages of something like, say, saying in terms of taming ego clinging, in terms of, as it were, kind of moving away from something or even getting rid of something, is it leaves things open quite wide to the imagination. We're left to imagine what would it be like to be free of something, something we're perhaps quite familiar with. What would it be like to be free of that, and leaving that to the imagination, saying, rather than trying to pin it down and fix it. But what we can say it isn't, and this is really important, it's not that there's literally an ego that we're trying to get rid of. That's sometimes how it's often spoken of, isn't it? We're trying to go beyond the self or even get rid of the self. But this can be really problematic. It can become very nihilistic, very much obsessed on cessation, on trying to get rid of something. It can become a form of self-hatred, self-destructive hatred in the name of Buddhism, rather than seeing this Dharma life as something incredibly positive, attractive, an open-ended adventure, full of potentiality, full of positive qualities. So yeah, it's not just a case, I don't think it, and this is how Bhante's often spoke about the danger of thinking in terms of trying to just get rid of the ego. But I think what is really positive about this idea of letting go of ego clinging is it's speaking a very affective language. It's saying we're clinging, this is something we're doing all the time. It's something we do. It's not just that we've got this wrong view, like our views, our kind of spectacles are tinted, which could seem, you know, it's like there's this thing we've got and we need to, again, like get rid of the wrong vision. That has its advantages as well, but this is speaking very affective language that we're clinging to something and we need to stop. We need to let go of that clinging. And that is what all Dharma practice is about. Bringing that about in ourselves and in others and in the world at large. So I think it's so important, just to say again, to have a positive vision of what this might mean. As I said, it's good to leave it open to the imagination, but I think some help would be beneficial. So I've got Bhante as a backup, and this is from Living with Awareness. Another incredible book. If you've not read it, read it. This is top quality stuff. This is from the chapter Suffering and Ceasing to Suffer. And he's talking about it's really important not to take things too literally, take statements too literally, and to take the path in too negative a view, to see it in terms of what you were just trying to get rid of. So he says, it might be better to imagine a day of unfettered inspiration and free-flowing energy, a day in which you were able to be completely true and clear in your communication, a day in which you felt so real a connection with others that your own concerns ceased to loom so balefully over your life, a day in which you never felt as though you were banging your head against a brick wall or getting stuck in a rut. Imagine such a day of creative freedom, and then imagine that freedom doubled or trebled and continuing to expand, and you will start to get an idea of the nature of enlightenment. So in letting go of ego clinging, in taming ego clinging, fulfilling this purpose that all Dharma, all teachings are leading towards, we're moving from something negative, restricted, to something much, much greater. There's always this movement towards something incredibly positive. And so as he says, moving towards unfettered inspiration, moving from being blocked to blocked energy to free-flowing energy, true and clear communication, and we have a feeling of real and true connection with others, so love, compassion, expansive connection with others. And you can see from this kind of one notion of as it were letting go, it opens up this vast array of qualities, different qualities, but all stemming from this freedom, this kind of relinquishing of the thing that gets most in the way of all of this, which is our ego, self-obsessed, neurotic clinging. Again, not that there's actually a self that we're clinging to. There's sort of what I kind of want to finish on actually is a particular image, which I feel really evokes this, that several people I think have actually made me aware of before. And it's an image of, in terms of letting go of ego clinging, moving from a clenched fist to an open hand, So it's going from this to this. And this is how Bhante's spoken about. I think it might have been Living Wisely, that it isn't actually that we've got an ego that we're clinging to. We're just this tight fist. It's a process. It's something that we're doing. It's not something we've got that we need to lose. We're doing this. We're clenching our fist. If only we could just release that clenching, and a whole world of beauty and meaning, love, truth, connection, free-flowing energy, delight, joy, happiness, all that will emerge from that process. And where that leads, well, it's a mystery, and in its way it's good to keep it a mystery. But nonetheless, at the best of times, I feel like, what we're embarking on with the Dharma life is vast, it is endless, it is this endless adventure. And we engage in that in so many different ways: our work, our service, our meditation, friendship, play, all these many different things that have all these different aspects to them, different sort of qualities, and yet they all have this one aim, it all agrees at one point. And if we can, I know I am, I'm always sort of trying to keep in touch with that sense of that, what is that, that essence, that taste of freedom which is spoken of, that says the Dharma, all Dharma has the taste of freedom, as a guide, as a beacon, as a light to help guide me forwards in that. So this has been my kind of short sort of ramble around the theme, something I find very inspiring, and I hope you can draw inspiration from it as well. I hope you have a wonderful retreat. I hope you're able to continue to engage creatively with this time that we're in at the moment, and wishing you all the best.